Good morning and welcome to St. Andrews online worship experience. We are so glad that you took the time today to be with us. Today's service will last about an hour. There'll be worship songs that you can sing to at home. There'll be a prayer time, which we encourage you to pray along with us. And God's word will be read and explained in the preaching. And I am sure today's service will be impactful. Please listen for God to speak to you. So now as we prepare to go to worship, let's take a second to listen to God's word, to put aside all the things from yesterday and all the worries about today or in the week, and take a moment to focus on God's word as it calls us to worship. Listen to me, my people. Hear me, my nation. Instruction will go out for me. My justice will become a light to the nations. My righteousness draws near speedily. My salvation is on the way, and my arm will bring justice to the nations. The islands will look to me and wait in hope for my arm.
The light, He is the Lord. Let us pray. Father God, we come before you this morning, not only to thank you for this glorious day, but to acknowledge you as our God, our Creator, our Savior, and our one true eternal love. You made us in your image. This we are told in your word, the Holy Bible, which you have given to us. We belong to you. Our purpose on this earth is to worship, praise, and adore you. We were made by you and placed in a garden. Everything we needed, you gave to us. We did not obey you. We did not love you. We failed. We were evicted. but the eviction was temporary. Your Son, our Savior, redeemed us, and we were given the opportunity to return to your presence. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for not turning your back. Thank you for not giving up on us. We can speak to you, Father, to read your word, to listen to your voice as you instruct us from your holy word. Your Holy Spirit never leaves us alone. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for loving us. We confess our sins of omission and commission as we do what we shouldn't and do not do what we should. We confess, we repent, and ask your forgiveness. We pray, Heavenly Father, for your wisdom and guidance as we move forward in the light of the decisions made at the General Assembly of the Presbyterian Church of Canada. Let your spirit of love and truth guide us here at St. Andrews. Thank you for your continued presence in our lives. Help us to keep our eyes on you always. We pray in your Son's mighty name. Amen.
So how many Beatles fans are there here? Few people? Yeah, okay. So you know the song, there's a song that they have, kind of a unique song called Being for the Benefit of Mr. Kite, which was on their Sgt. Pepper's album, the best album, according to Rolling Stone, of all time. So, a little lesson here. If you've heard the song, you know, it actually reproduces an old, like, 19th century circus poster that John Lennon came across, and he wrote a song about the words on this poster. And he goes to his music producer, and so he's written the words of this song, you know, again, just mostly what's already there. He goes to the producer, George Martin, and he says, I want people to feel like they're at the circus when they listen to this song. He said, I want them to smell the sawdust. You know, he was creative that way, just kind of spoke in these images. So George Martin, a brilliant music producer, what he did was he went out and he got recordings of calliope music, you know, calliope, like that kind of thing, and Sousa, you know, Sousa marches. I forget what Sousa's first name was, but anyway, you know, the like kind of music like that. He went out and got recordings of that music, tapes of it, and cut the tape into, I don't know, a few inches, cut it all up, threw it up in the air, and then got one of his assistants to put it all together, to splice it all together. And this then formed kind of the background music. It's not front and center in the song, but it's a background music of the song throughout, and it's brilliant. Now, why am I telling you all this? It's really, I'm not really wanting to give you a music history lesson. But the passage that we come to today as we continue with the Sermon on the Mount, it seems to me is kind of like these bits of tape that have been thrown up and someone has kind of taken them and spliced them back together. We're going to be looking at Matthew 7, verses 1 to 12. And there are, as I read the passage, and as I read the passage initially and without sort of thinking, you know, what is, how is this going to get, it seems like there are three distinct pieces to this passage. Distinct in that, well, what does this have to do with that? And what does that have to do with this over here? It seems like these are pieces that have been picked up off the editing room floor by Matthew, I guess, and kind of said, oh, well, I don't really have anywhere else for them, so I'm just going to put them together here. And so I struggled looking at this. I say, I believe that there's got to be a thread. I believe that Jesus in his teaching and Matthew, as he decides sort of here's how I'm going to write this down a number of years later and present it to you, that he's not just splicing random bits together. I made that point earlier with the Sermon on the Mount. This is not just random bits of teaching put together. There's a thread. There's a meaning. There's a flow. And so I believe that there is a thread that goes through this passage, and we're going to talk about that in a few moments. But if you haven't been with us for a little while, or this is your first time with us, I just want to give you a bit of a recap of where we've been on the Sermon on the Mount. I'll do it pretty quickly because some of you have been here throughout and you probably don't need the recap. But here it is. The Sermon on the Mount really is Jesus' message for all people about the presence and availability of God's kingdom of the heavens, God's kingdom breaking in amongst our earthly kingdoms. Kingdoms that are actually, you know, cities and countries, but also the kingdoms of our hearts. That God's kingdom is now available and we can bring our own little kingdoms, our families, our lives, our hearts, and to make them part of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of the heavens is at hand, Jesus said. And then at the beginning of chapter 5, Jesus gives the Beatitudes, and really it's an open invitation to say, do you think this doesn't apply to you? Well, let me tell you, blessed are the poor. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are those who are persecuted. No, this is for you. This isn't just for the wealthy. This isn't just for those who seem to have it all together. This is a call. This is an invitation that goes out to everyone. God's blessing is open to all. And then as he goes on in chapter 5, he focuses on what it means to be in right relationship with one another. He talks about very practical things like anger, lust, divorce, revenge, love for all people, even love for our enemies, okay? And we talked every week then about these are not rules that he's making up to say, these are now the new rules that you must follow. What he's doing is he's giving illustrations. This is what it looks like for of a heart. This is what it looks like when a heart is submitted to the kingdom of the heavens. These are illustrations of a kingdom heart, a heart ruled by God. And as we got into chapter 6, we moved from relationships with other people, and we moved more into, well, this is what a right relationship with God looks like. He talked about kind of spiritual life and religious observance, things like fasting, things like prayer, things like almsgiving, that these things arise out of devotion to God and not out of what we think other people are seeing when they look at us practicing these things, okay? So, you know, don't go out into the, don't stand on the street and pray. Don't let everyone know, you know, by you're looking down, you know, you're fasting. No, do it privately, do it secretly, and your God who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Prayer, he says, is about aligning with God's will and not about just asking for the stuff that we want or the stuff even that we think we need. It's about aligning with God's will. And then he goes on to talk about how our treasure shouldn't be in things of the earth, but our treasure should be in God, in heaven. And not just a treasure God, that, but as we talked about last week, that we need to put our trust in God. Do not worry. Tomorrow has enough worries of its own. Today, just trust in God. He is there with you. And that brings us to the passage that we're going to look at today. So the beginning of chapter 7, Matthew chapter 7. And as I often like to do, we're just going to read a few verses at a time and then kind of dig into it and explore it together. But before we do that, let's take a moment and pray. Father, as we open your word now, and as I admit, was a passage that I found rather tricky to see, how does this actually go together? Lord, we pray that you would open our ears to hear your voice, that you would open our minds to understand what is being said to us. And you will open our hearts to receive your living word, to receive your Holy Spirit, who guides and leads us in this and in all things. And we pray these things in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. So Matthew 7, verses 1 and 2. I think you'll find that those of you who have been in Scripture for many years, you'll find this to be a very familiar passage throughout. But here is what he says, Jesus says in verses 1 and 2. He says, "Do not judge. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you." So I'm just going to stop there with those first two verses. And that's such a straightforward and clear message, isn't it? Do not judge. It's very clear. You have no right, you have no call. Jesus tells you, it's not your job to judge other people. Can I ask you this question? Can I ask you this honest question. I'm not going to ask you to put your hand up. Do you have any issues with judgment and judgmentalism in your heart? I know I can raise my hand. I know I do. It's a pretty common human tendency. And here's the thing. You know, when we hear the teachings of Jesus, you know what the natural tendency is? We, and especially those of us in the church, especially us, we hear Jesus' teachings and we say, preach it, my Lord. Absolutely. I agree. Oh, yes. That is so right on. We're with you. But look at that guy. I mean, whew, does he ever have anger issues? Whoa, do you hear the kind of language that he uses? Man, her, she's been divorced twice over there. Yeah, wow. And this guy, man, boy, his struggles with lust and her, my goodness. Is she, can she be any more fixated on appearance and clothing and jewelry and makeup? My goodness. Boy, yeah, we're with you. But they could use some work. Better fix them. I mean, I think I've played it up a little bit. I hope that we don't actually say things or even think things quite in that way. But boy, it's there, isn't it? The spirit of judgmentalism, the spirit of condemnation is alive and well. And friends, we in the church, I think, most especially need to beware of this. It comes in so easily. It comes in so quickly. See, what we do, whether we realize we're doing it or not, we have this way of making ourselves feel like we're on the inside. We're part of the in crowd, okay? We're the good ones. And the way we have of doing that mostly is by looking at others and seeing how they're not. Because, well, I mean, look at them. Look how they act. Look at what they do. You know, look at what they believe or don't believe. So they're on the outside. We're on the inside. And so what we do is we find fault and we draw lines, right? That's why I called the message to today, fault lines. We like to find fault and we like to draw lines. I'm not necessarily talking about geographical tectonic plates shifting and causing earthquakes and things like that. But Jesus comes in, he says, whoa, not your job, not your place. You, in fact, do not have the qualifications to stand in the role of judge. So just don't do it. Just stay away from it. Now, some of you may know a couple of weeks ago, I was actually called for jury duty. First time ever. I don't know how I got to, 50 plus years old, and it's the first time I've ever been called for jury duty. Some of you, I think, have probably been called multiple times. But anyway, got called for jury duty, and first 15 go in, wasn't me. I'm like, okay, I don't really want to be called, because it's going to take up some time. It was a criminal case, was going to take a couple of weeks. Anyway. But the second 15 people who got called, my number gets called, and I have to go off. And I get called in before the judge, and sure enough, I am said, yeah, there's no reason why you can't be a juror. So I was alternate juror number one. I missed being on the jury by one place. But anyway, as alternate juror, I was supposed to come to the beginning of the trial until testimony was begun, and then I was free to go. But what the judge said to the jury was, he didn't call us jurors. He said, you are the judges of this case. He said, really, my role is to kind of make sure that the law is being followed and to decide how the law applies and doesn't apply and things like that. He's overseeing all of that. But you, the jury, you are the judges. Because the jury and the judge, really, they're the only ones who hear and consider all of the evidence. You know, the media certainly doesn't hear and know all of the evidence, even though there probably was stories about this crime that happened. He said, you can't look at that. They don't have, you're the ones who are going to hear all of the testimony and know all of the evidence. And so, just as it's only the judge and jury who hear all of that, here's the thing. God is the only one who hears and knows all the evidence, knows all the testimony, knows all about it. He's the only one who can judge, and he does so perfectly. And he does so with love and with grace, as well as with truth and with justice. To my human heart, I don't exactly know how he's able to bring all of those things together in a perfect way. But that's what he can do. And that's why it is his place. We're not privy to most of what truly makes up a person's life, the vast majority. And so we are not in a place to judge. See, friends, we're a community of the imperfect, traveling towards, we hope, perfection, journeying toward abundant life. We're a community in which every member puts their trust in him, in which every member entrusts him or herself to God's mercy, entrusts ourselves to his loving judgment. And as God has been generous and gracious to us in his judgment of us, we have our promise from God that he will judge us with truth. Yes, that can be a scary thing. With justice, but also with grace and with love. And so we can be generous, we can be gracious in our judgment, which we're not called to do, but in our judgment of others, as God has been gracious to us. Now, it's at this point that we often get a little bit of pushback, and I understand it, but the pushback goes something like this. Well, what are you saying? So anything goes? We just leave it to God, and God is love and grace, and so just you can do anything you want because God's going to forgive everything? It's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is what God forgives and doesn't forgive isn't our business. It's his. It's only our business insofar as to know who he is and to know him more. So it's not that we call good and celebrate what the scripture doesn't call good, or in fact, even what the scripture calls not good. In my opinion, I think this is the problem that our denomination has gotten itself into, but I'm not going to go down that road today. Friends, we need to recognize our own failings. We need to recognize our own failings and act out of love, not condemnation. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. So it goes on now in verse 3. Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there is a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the plank out of your own eye, and then you'll see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Do not give to dogs what is sacred. Do not throw your pearls to pigs. If you do, they may trample them under their feet and turn and tear you to pieces. And again, we'll stop there for now. So verses 3 to 5 seem to follow along. Do not judge. Okay, well, yeah, why are you looking at the speck? Why are you judging your brother or your sister for the speck in their eye when you've got a plank in your own? I mean, this is hyperbole, right? It's obviously a metaphor. but how is it that we do that? He says that we do that all the time. But here's the thing. Verses 3 to 5 are about the community of faith. Talk to his language of brother, fellow believer. Not necessarily blood family member, but faith family member. Okay. Verse 6 then starts talking about pigs and dogs. I understand when you talk about pigs and dogs within a Jewish context, a biblical Jewish context, it's referring to outsiders. These were common terms, derogatory terms that were used about Gentile people, those who were not part of the Jewish faith. Okay. So we read verses 3 to 5 and we can understand that pretty clearly. Don't judge someone else when, you know, you've got these three fingers pointing back at you, you know, that kind of thing. Got a plank in your own eye. But verse 6, I find, is a bit trickier. The meaning of verse 6 on the surface might seem clear. Don't waste your time on dogs and pigs. You know, that's all they are. They're dogs and pigs. But the problem is when we read this in the context of the Sermon on the Mount, if you just read that one verse, it seems, oh, well, I guess we shouldn't have anything to do with dogs and pigs, those outsiders. But when we look at the whole context, I think it's saying something different. In some ways, I think he is kind of saying, yeah, don't waste your time. But not because they're dogs and pigs, but because what you're trying to feed them is actually very unhelpful. It's not going to do anything for them. What is a pearl going to do for a pig? Right? Holy things and pearls aren't actually helpful, aren't actually doing anything of benefit for a pig or a dog, right? What we might see as having great value are our pearls of wisdom, our doctrines, our laws. These valuable things may have absolutely no value or very little value to those who don't hold the same values, right? And more than just falling on deaf ears, it might actually cause a backlash. It might turn and tear you to pieces. So maybe it's not so good for you. I mean, but this leaves us feeling that those pigs and dogs, quote unquote, are triply at fault, right? First of all, they're non-believers, they're outsiders, okay? Second, they're not listening. They won't listen to me, my pearls of wisdom, my pearls of doctrine. And then third, sometimes they actually lash out at me. So, you know, if anyone's worthy of judgment, you know, who is that going to be? But wait a minute. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. Friends, if we're trying to force feed our points of view, our pearls, our holy things, maybe we need to see that there are more basic things, more basic needs that need to be addressed and met first. Maybe it's a physical need. Maybe it's someone who doesn't have enough to eat, who's struggling to meet their necessary payments each month. Maybe there's more basic needs of just someone, the need for love, the need for respect, the need for care, acceptance, friendship. Not to mention, yes, there is, of course, the need to know the truth and grace of Christ. To know God's loving judgment, not our self-centered judgment. So just as we try to fix other believers, we try to see the speck in my sister's eye, in my brother's eye, and try to remove that speck when I really, how can I see? Just as we try to fix other believers, so we also try to fix non-believers too, offering our pearls of wisdom, our precious but unhelpful pearls, to those who have no frame of reference for their actual value. For both of these, I believe here Jesus is saying, whoa, not your job, not your place. You don't have the qualifications. Do not judge. Don't look at the specks in others' eyes. Don't offer or focus really what is unhelpful to them. So friends, I think the basic question for those of us who would call ourselves followers of Jesus, and anyone exploring what that might mean, I think the basic question is something like this. Okay, because we're coming near to the end of the sermon, right? Certainly not to the end of the gospel. There's a lot left. But we're coming near to the end of the sermon. So I think the basic question is this. Okay, now that we're coming to the end of the sermon, now that we know what we know about Jesus, now that we've heard what he has to say, now that we've caught a glimpse of the kingdom vision that he's holding out for us, now that we've accepted Jesus' invitation to live within the kingdom of the heavens, how are we to relate to other people, both believers and non-believers alike? How can we impact others with the good news? That's what I think the question is. And that's what I think, in some ways, Jesus goes on to answer in these next few verses. So let's read verses 7 to 12. So Jesus continues on. He says, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And the one who knocks, and to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Now, which of you, if your son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? So in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you. For this sums up the law and the prophets. So Jesus, I think, gives two answers to the question. How are we to treat, now that we know what we know, now that we're trying to live within the kingdom, how do we treat others? I think he gives at least two answers here. I want to start with the second answer, and we'll work back to the first. So Jesus says, you want to impact others for me? Then for one thing, treat them with the love, the care, and the respect that I always did, even if they have specks in their eyes, right? Even if they seem little better than pigs or dogs to you, treat them the way that I treated them. And the way he sums that up in verse 12 is, do to others what you would have them do to you. You remember, Jesus has just told us that we have no special privileges or rights over others. We have no right to condemn. We have no right to push our pearls of truth and salvation onto unwilling and possibly, you know, uncomprehending recipients. And now here he offers us this, it's really a simple rule of thumb, that even, I think, even the most unsophisticated follower of Jesus puts it in terms that even the most unsophisticated follower will be able to understand and want to know whether their relationships are along the right lines or not. What we need to do is put ourselves in the place of the other person. It's pretty simple, right? If I was that person, what would I want me to do in this situation? Would I want to be treated the way I am treating her? The way I'm treating him, the way I'm treating them. And we need to be careful with this too, because we need to recognize that it's not simply that do to others as you would have them do to you. So I think, well, this is what I would want, so this is what I'm going to do to them. No. What is it that they would want? And how can I do that for them? The heart of this command is to do to others as they themselves would want done, not what we would want. When I was about to turn 40, and we're leading up to sort of this potentially big, you know, celebration for my 40th birthday, actually at one point decided, you know, I'm just gonna talk to my wife and ask her, like, so what's the, because I knew she was planning something, but I didn't know, and I had some thoughts and ideas about what I wanted to do, and so I asked, will you tell me what's the plan? Well, we're going to have a quiet get-together with some good close friends. I wanted a big party. You know, I'm turning 40. I mean, like, that's it. That's the end of life, you know? Like, you're over the hill. You might as well party one last time. I wanted a big party with lots of people to come. And it was just kind of, so I told her that, and we kind of changed gears. It was a little last minute. But I'll tell you something. I learned something that day. And what I learned was not, oh, my wife doesn't really know what I want. No, that's not what I learned. Not at all. What I learned was, for her 40th birthday, I should plan a small get-together with just a few close friends to come, because that's what she wants. That's what she wants in that situation. Whereas my instinct would have been to throw a big party, because that's what I want. But that's the trick, right? What does the other person want? What is going to benefit them? What's good for them in this situation? You know? Of course, if we say, well, of course I'd like to hear all about salvation, because that's, you know, so crucial, that's so important. If we say that, we aren't considering how the other person may perceive our notions of salvation. Again, it's like throwing a big party for someone who wants a small gathering. It's like offering a pearl to a pig. No matter how well-intentioned, the thing is, it's unhelpful. Jesus tells us to ask ourselves, what is helpful to this person? Go and do that. Go and do that. But Jesus says more than that. That's one way he has of answering. So how can we, you know, how can we live this out? He says, you really want to know how to impact others for me? Okay. Then ask. Ask me, ask God how you can be of help. Seek, search out God's will. Knock on the doors of possibilities. Is it this? Should I try this? Is that working? No, that's not working out. Okay, I'm going to knock on this door. It's this. I'm going to try this, over here. Ask, seek, knock. You want to be in right relationship with other people? Then be in right relationship with God. What is he talking about here? He's talking about, talk to me. Talk to God about it. Be in prayer over this. You want to be in right relationship with other people? Be in right relationship with God. Follow his lead. Ask him. Seek his will and his kingdom. Knock on whatever doors of possibility and opportunity may come along and see how he leads. These are familiar words, aren't they? Ask, seek, knock. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door will be opened unto you. Boy, I could write a song about that, I think. But note the context. Again, don't just take one verse. What's the context? The context here is not you and me asking for stuff that we want. Although I think it could fit in other contexts as well. But the context here is, how can we be of service to other people? How can we serve with love and grace? How can we love instead of judging others? How can we love instead of judging? How can we love instead of judging? Wow. That's like a summary, a concise summary of the kingdom. It's the heart of the kingdom. It's the heart of the church. The church, friends, is to be a place not of judgment, but of love and grace, as Christ showed us love and grace. And again, this is not the same as ignoring fault. This is not the same as ignoring sin. We do need to recognize sin. We do need to recognize fault and see it for what it is and know how that impacts us and how we are to live ourselves. But here's the thing. Judging something to be wrong, which we need to do, and judging someone for their particular wrongdoing are two totally different things. Let me say that again. Judging something to be wrong, to be sinful, to be at fault, to know how it impacts us in our lives. We need to be able to do that, absolutely. But judging someone for their particular sins is something we absolutely must not do. Judge not, lest ye be judged. What would the church look like if we were able to take this to heart? What would the church be if we were able to do this? What would the world look like if this were actually to take root in the church? What a difference we could be, what a difference we could make. Because friends, we've spent far too long drawing lines and finding fault. Maybe the time has come to allow the way of non-judgmental love to come to the fore, to become the fault line of faith, to become the fault line of our lives, the fault line that will draw people to the life-giving truth of the gospel of Christ. And I think that would be a tectonic shift that would shake things up in a wonderful way, that would change the shape of our lives, that would change the shape of the world forever. Judge not, lest ye be judged. Don't look at the speck in your brother's eye when you have a plank in your own. Don't offer things that are going to be unhelpful and unnecessary to others. Look to God. Ask, seek, knock. And in all things, do to others what you would have them do to you. There's a lot more to be said, but in many ways this summarizes such a key element of the gospel that if the church, if we could take this to heart, again, it would, I can't even imagine, it would make all the difference in the world. So just take a moment and think on that. Allow that to sink into our hearts, our minds, our lives, to know that the more that we are able to live out who Jesus calls us to be, the more that the grace and truth of the gospel will be lived out and will be known in the world around us. So, Father, we turn to you. We do ask. We seek you and your will. We knock on, well, we're just knocking on the door, seeking you, seeking your purpose, seeking your direction. There are many ways in which we'll need to do this for ourselves as a congregation, and certainly ways that we need to do this each in our own lives, with our families, our friends. Lord, may this truly take root more and more and bear fruit in who we are and how we live for you, for the sake of your kingdom. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Bringing hope to the world. So we want to bless you individually and collectively. We want to bless you as individuals who love the Lord. We want to bless you as people who are coming to know the Lord more and more and more. We ask that your deep and abiding faith be expressed in all the things that you do. We ask that this church be a beacon and a place of refuge. We ask that depending on where the church ends up, we just ask that you would be for Christ, that Christ would be your mainstay. We bless you to go out into the world, to do all the things that he has created you as a specific individual to do. And we give him the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Hello. Thank you for tuning in to St. Andrew's online worship service this morning. Subscribe, share, like, or leave a comment or question below and we'll get back to you. Today, June 19th, we'll hold a congregational planning and budget meeting after the service. I would encourage you to attend the meeting to have a voice in the conversation and decisions. We look forward to seeing you there. It will be on Zoom, and the link for the Zoom connection is in the weekly email. Reverend Steve Lindsay will be our 100th anniversary speaker on June 26th. And for the first time in over 2 years, we will follow the service with refreshments in the fellowship hall. June 26th will be Pastor Sean's last day before his intermission. He'll return in September. If you have any pastoral needs during this time, please contact your elder or call the office at 416-233-9800. Thank you for your continued financial offerings, which support the life and work of St. Andrews, by check, by hitting the donate button on the website, through e-transfers to office@standrewsislington.org, or through the pre-authorized remittance program. If you're interested in using numbered offering envelopes or the pre-authorized remittance program, please contact the office. Now, before we close the video, here are some questions from the message we heard this morning. See you soon at the congregational meeting on Zoom.